This is the story of how the free market is going out of fashion. How all the things it was once lauded for may no longer be true.
The average person is a lot poorer than when I was young. They have more junk, but they have worse health care.
The idea of a free market is a myth. It's not something that actually exists in real life.
In this video, we'll look at what is driving the shift towards increasing government intervention.
We'll zoom in on America's Inflation Reduction Act as an example of a radically shifting industrial policy.
The US are moving us all to the Chinese system.
And ask, do big crises call for big government? That's all coming up on Business Beyond.
When people talk about a free market, they generally mean an economy that's driven by supply and demand with very little intervention from the government. At its best, it's competitive, efficient, and productive.
Most economies fall on a spectrum between centrally planned like China and close to completely free like Singapore. But any system considered capitalist, think Germany, the US, or Japan, for example, fall closer to the free market end.
The market giveth, the market taketh away, blessed be the market. That's really a period we've been living through since, you know, about early 1980s. Some people trace that to Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher, and they really ushered in this belief that government should be small, that taxes should be low, and that businesses should basically be able to do what they want, and that would bring some kind of good.
For a while, the free market had a pretty good rep, credited for paving the way towards more prosperity for all. But in recent times, perceptions have begun to change, and nowhere more notably so than the United States.
Since the 1990s, the average person's wealth has not grown at all. Their income has not grown. Only in the top 10%, really, maybe a bigger percentage, but most of it's really around the top 3%. I mean, people's incomes are really going up and the rest of people's are just not. And that, you can truly see that. The average person is a lot poorer than when I was young. They have more junk, but they have worse health care. They don't have access to education in the same way. Anyway, so these are complex things.
That sense of declining prosperity in places like this in Detroit, Michigan, was a big part of former President Donald Trump's rise to power. His slogan, America First, became a rallying cry for economic nationalism.
All you want is a government that shows you the same respect and loyalty in return. You believe that America must protect and defend its own citizens. With that conviction deep in your hearts, you showed up on Election Day, November 8th, and voted to put America first.
Not everyone agrees that Trump's policies actually amounted to a move away from the free market.
Yeah, I really don't think that's the case. I mean, at the end of the day, the previous administration, the Trump administration's landmark piece of legislation was a massive tax cuts for the rich and corporations, right? It's the Trump tax cuts, the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act. And that piece of legislation really subscribed to very traditional neoliberal and free market ideas that if people at the top are doing well, then the economy is doing well. And that's just not the approach that this administration has taken, certainly.
When exactly American policy began to shift away from free market ideals is up for debate. But one thing you can't argue with is that the perils of relying on market forces alone became apparent in a whole new light during the pandemic.
The pandemic, which was so sudden, so visceral, and so economically devastating, in addition to being devastating on a emotional and public health grounds, that definitely showed us that government is necessary, right? That even though many vaccines were in fact developed by private companies, because that's the infrastructure we have, it took government action to speed those up.
What we learned in the COVID crisis is that we have to have certain things on the ground, medical stuff, for example, mask making. We didn't have any masks. We didn't make any masks.
The crisis triggered massive state intervention. Around the world, governments spent billions fighting COVID, handing out stimulus checks, funding vaccine research, and subsidizing salaries so employers could keep on their staff. Then, just as the world was beginning to emerge from the pandemic, another crisis hit, once again exposing the limitations of the free market. As well as causing untold human suffering, Russia's war in Ukraine triggered enormous economic volatility, especially on the food and energy markets. Inflation soared, and once again, governments intervened. In the EU, lawmakers capped the price of gas and forced electricity companies to pass on surplus revenue to consumers. They also introduced the largest ever recovery investment plan, worth more than 800 billion euros.
So much for just letting the market do its thing. And sure, these measures were driven by crises, but they were also part of a trend that began many years before.
Since 2009, the number of state subsidies in place globally has risen 20-fold. Much of that has to do with China's rapid growth. Remember, its economy is based on massive state investment and control of the private sector. In one area in particular, these policies have enabled it to garner a crucial competitive advantage: clean energy. According to 2021 figures from the International Energy Agency, Chinese state investment in the sector significantly exceeds that of the European Union and the United States. But in the area of solar energy, China is not alone in investing heavily. Over the past 20 years, several other countries have also pumped billions of dollars into the industry, creating a thriving market for the sun's energy. But has all this government intervention actually paid off for citizens? The short answer is yes. In recent years, we've seen a massive decline in the cost of solar compared to other clean energy sources, like offshore wind and even nuclear.
So in the case of solar, subsidies proved hugely beneficial. But is government intervention always the answer? Let's take a look at one of the most ambitious spending plans the US has ever embarked on, the Inflation Reduction Act.
Signed into law on August 16, 2022, it's a landmark piece of legislation that includes a massive $369 billion investment plan to fund clean energy projects.
It's now law.
Think solar farms, electric vehicles, carbon capture, and clean hydrogen.
It sounds pretty great, right? A government finally getting serious about tackling climate change. But there's another side to this. The Inflation Reduction Act is also a textbook definition of protectionism, focused on safeguarding domestic industry from foreign competition. Here's just one example.
The IRA offers electric car buyers a $7,500 tax credit on three conditions. The vehicle's final assembly has to take place in North America. 50% of the battery components have to be produced there. And at least 40% of the critical minerals used for the vehicle have to be extracted, processed, or recycled in the US or a country it has a free trade agreement with.
Those domestic production requirements are pretty much the opposite of free market philosophy. Leaders here in Europe accuse the United States of not playing fair.
Competition is good. We like it. It's important. But you expected a but in all this. But this competition must respect a level playing field. And that's why it is so critical that the technology competition between the European Union and the United States is a race to the top for our industries on both sides of the Atlantic.
One year on, the effects of the Inflation Reduction Act are already plain to see. Since its introduction, Volkswagen, Mercedes, BMW, Hyundai, Toyota, and Honda have all announced major investments in North America. This is basically exactly what Europe was afraid of, companies fleeing its shores to avail of US subsidies. But what to do about it? The conventional place to complain about another country engaging in unfair trade practices is the World Trade Organization.
There were some rumblings in the EU about doing this, but in the end, nothing happened. I asked former WTO Chief Pascal Lamy why.
I think this decision has been taken on political grounds, not to be nice to our American friends who are fighting with us in Ukraine, which is a reasonably strong argument, although I might not have taken this decision.
Another reason is that the WTO currently doesn't have a functioning dispute resolution system. But that's another story. Anyway, here in the EU, the reaction to the Inflation Reduction Act basically boiled down to, if you can't beat them, join them.
The bloc opted for more market intervention, allowing member states to subsidise companies making solar panels, wind turbines, heat pumps and carbon capture mechanisms. Again, more state, less free market.
So with the Inflation Reduction Act and the industrial policy we are seeing in the EU, we can definitely say that we are seeing a fundamental shift in how economic policy is being done. And it also entails that the economic policy is more protectionist than it was before.
Some commentators interpret this trend as a rejection of free trade and a move towards a centrally planned economy like China's.
The US are moving us all to the Chinese system. I mean economically, of course, not politically, thank God.
The Inflation Reduction Act has triggered a lot of press speculation about whether the United States and Europe now find themselves in a subsidy race. Whether or not it's the case, not everyone agrees it would actually be a bad thing.
What we're talking about here is more a race to the top rather than a race to the bottom, and doing that in industries that are really infant. And so this is kind of a classic development economy approach, which is important to recognize when you're talking about whole sectors that don't really even exist at scale in the United States or in Europe.
Others say the framing of the question itself misses the point.
I don't think it's really a race between the US and the EU. It's more a race between humanity versus climate change that we really need to win, and we need to win that fast. So it's really good that governments are now starting to support the growth of green industries much more so that we can produce green clean tech products that we urgently need.
In this video, we've talked a lot about how various crises have exposed the failures of the free market. But what about the strengths we mentioned earlier? Productivity, efficiency, and competitiveness. How can we ensure they don't get lost amid all this state intervention?
I'm not the kind of person who thinks there's absolutely no trade-off. I don't think you can have perfect equity always in every case. But I do think that the trade-off between equity and efficiency isn't where we might have thought if we were sitting here having this conversation in 1982.
A number of experts I spoke to pointed to one country in particular that appears to have got the balance right, South Korea.
A few decades ago, it was one of the poorest countries in the world. Today, it's an industrial powerhouse, home to some of the most high-tech companies in the world. So how did they do it?
They managed to transform themselves from an agricultural economy with people starving because they were so poor into this international economic powerhouse that they are now, you know, with Samsung and other superstar producers. And the way they did that is they supported and protected their industries. And they did that. They didn't just give away free handouts to companies, but what they did instead is they made it conditional on the achievement of performance goals. And that way, the South Korean government made sure that only the most productive firms survived and that they could build very competitive industries. And we can do the same thing now with green industries by tying government support to green and social performance goals to make sure that only the most productive, but also the most green and social firms survive this transformation.
The traditional free market idea of public investment would suggest that when public dollars flow in, private money flows out. And in fact, that's exactly the opposite of what we're seeing, right? We've invested a huge amount of money in the semiconductor industry. And in fact, we're seeing a lot of crowding in of private investment, billions and billions of dollars. So I think that's one really important proof point that public investment actually does work differently in reality than it does within the confines of an Econ 101 textbook.
With the world facing so many crises, it's no surprise that we've come to an inflection point when it comes to how we talk about the free market. But experts say from a historical perspective, there have always been cracks.
So we're constantly having crises, the state's constantly stepping in, And what I say is, since this historically is all we've seen, we've never seen the dream actually work. Under Reagan, under Thatcher, there was a lot of liberalization, lots of crises, and lots of state intervention and lots of state spending, various points. Since that seems to be the way things work, we should try and be getting that right rather than following this bizarre modernist, I would say nihilistic mantra of no state. I mean, what is that? Like Somalia? I don't know. It's a crazy idea if you just think about it clearly. Less state intervention, hands off a little bit, sure, but no state. That's, it's an extreme philosophical standpoint, which is taken seriously philosophically, but does not exist in the real world.
With the war in Ukraine still raging and climate change posing an existential threat to the world, chances are we'll be seeing a whole lot more government intervention in the coming years. How that goes could well depend on how well the public and private sectors can work together.
And that brings us to the end of this edition of Business Beyond. We'd love to know what you think about the shift away from free market economics. And if you have a few minutes to spare, do check out some of our other videos. Until next time, from me and the team, it's goodbye and take care.